else's question?
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Just speaking to the amendment, I can't support this amendment. I find it difficult, some of the statements, you know, that if the amendment goes through, it will be supported, but if it doesn't go through, it won't, considering in both cases there's an ask, a request to pause work, and that's the main crux for the arguments against this. So I find it difficult in understanding what this is doing, except from my opinion, this actually introduces the risk of more delay. So if I give you some examples, we've had a clear answer from you this morning, Mayor, that you know, the Trumpington Park and Ride is perfectly obvious to everyone that will be going ahead. And I expect that for the June and July workshops, very near in the future, you'll be able to give a clear commitment on behalf of all of us. You know, these projects are not under threat. These are not the ones that the June and July support. Get on and deliver them. We all agree on them, such as the Trumpington Park and Ride. So to ask that everything to wait until the June and July board to meet, and then to demand that the June and July board, that everything has some sort of massive stack of evidence behind it before everything else can be done, worries me entirely, because what I'm looking for is some clear purpose of direction, one that the local transport plan that we're developing in the future will be an evidence-backed local transport plan that we can all get behind and deliver. And the second thing is just very clear guidance, you know, this can go forward, but this actually, it disagrees with the new way of thinking for the future, because, and here are the problems, and this is what we intend to do in the interim. So I can't support the amendment on that basis, but I will be supporting the overall paper as it stands.
Okay. Any other speakers on the amendments? So I have a proposal and a second, and I'd like to put it to the vote. This is the amendment. All those in favour? Those against? So we will now go back to debate the initial paper, initial report. Councillor Hogan.
Just a brief contribution. I did talk about some of the pressing issues of congestion in the city. I think that interchanges and park and rides will continue to be part of the need next to Cambridge. As I said, 3 million people every year use park and rides, and if they didn't come into Cambridge, the result would be that we would actually have even greater congestion and frequency of gridlock than we have now. We are, I appreciate that work by different consultants on the transport strategy might, during the course of next year, bring forward some new thinking. But we have got a range of options that we need to look at to tackle congestion. We are going to have gridlock before the metro comes on stream. And I cannot see any other consequence. We will obviously want to improve radically bus services, and we do want the bus review to include franchising and ways of encouraging better services right across the rural geography. Bus services, but also reduces the number of cars coming into the city. We have to manage that demand. So I would just urge, as part of the discussion, there to be a halfway opportunity for the Greater Cambridge Partnership to look at these options, to look at reconfiguring the city, whilst at the same time allowing quality of access. We do not want the city to depend on city centre car parks. We do need to have an interim solution that reduces cars into the city. So again, as evidenced at the moment, the report calls for work to be suspended on that. And I just think there is a huge amount of work done by ARUPS, who are also a source of expertise for the combined authority. And we just need to make progress on that. So I hope that that as a theme will be addressed as part of our discussions, Mayor.
Yeah, thank you. I don't want all of this to be just about Cambridge City and Greater Cambridge. There's a much more part of my reaching paper than that. But I would just comment that, you know, some comments about the risk to the local plan. Local plan has been running on for a few years now without cast iron routes, etc., going in when it was originally submitted. That, you know, so I don't see that threat.
I do think that the business community need the assurances from the mayor moving forward on the quick wins, the ones that they're worried about here on the day, coming forward as early as possible so the university, the businesses, the people coming in can have that assurance that certain works will be moving forward. And I do think that charging for me, congestion charging, just to put myself on record, is an area of last resort. You try absolutely everything before you start introducing additional tax burdens on the public. So, for example, let's just put it out there. When the county council agreed with the assistance of the Cambridge, the Great Cambridge Partnership, to revert back to free car parking on its sites outside. You know, it was forced into charging parking because we are strapped for cash and we look for every avenue, and we sometimes don't have the ability to make the largest of decisions for the greater good when we don't have the money to achieve it. But in the same vein, if you wanted to reduce cars coming into the city, you could reduce the amount of car parking available in the city, and that could have an automatic overnight effect, filling up all the park and rise spaces that are available. So there are other options that can be delivered before we consider congestion charging. And I want every single one of them to be thought through and ruled out before we ever approach that subject again. As a personal point of view, it is an area of last resort. In terms of the wider geography, we've lived in a world, and I alluded to it earlier about visions of the future, we've lived in a world for so long where we used to stopgap measures that we think it's the only option. Now, here is a plan being laid out and saying, you know what, if we have a different vision, we don't have to do a sticking plaster bandage over some of the problems of today. What we need to do is get from here and today and have a transition plan to get us to the future where we actually have a better world. Whatever system is used to get the people in, Cambridge, Peterborough, etc., if we can get people out of their cars, it has multiple benefits. Not just in terms of reducing congestion on the roads, but on air quality, on the health that we talked about, walking, cycling to these interchange points. You know, it is something that we should be striving for. And at this present point in time, I am worried that if we carry on with the sticking plaster approach, that we will never ever achieve, and we will rule ourselves out in a long-term vision. So at the moment, I'm very much behind this. I want to use the time between now and July to iron out those areas that can be moved forward at pace, and perhaps even speed it up, who knows. And then what I need to come out from July is a very clear message of what the interim measures are between the now and the vision for the future. And then as we work to the local transport plan, the new local transport plan, that is the point where we've got to make sure that everything is nailed down and evidence-led, that we actually have the evidence to support what we will bring forward for the future. So I'm very happy to support this paper.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Seaton.
Yes, thank you, Mark. I've been sitting here, I understand the concerns raised by councillors from Cambridge. They're obviously very important concerns. However, we have continued representative here, Peterborough, East Cambs and Fendon. Fendon can't get people out of cars particularly because there's no rail going into Fendon apart from March. We need very good bus services, which we don't have. And it's a very rural community, as is East Cambs and other parts of the combined authority. So, yes, I understand concerns from the city. But, we can't concentrate all the time on talking about the metro and, how it affects South Cambs and City. I'm concerned about, being for a film. And I'm sure, Councillor Butt is exactly the same with Councillor Bull with Huntingdon. And so, I want to widen this out rather than just... And this is the second time we've sat here talking about this transport policy, and all I've heard is Cambridge all the time, and I just think it needs widening out. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Seaton. Councillor Smith.
Thank you. So, just responding to Councillor Count, it's actually not true, I'm afraid, to say that the local plans aren't predicated on routes. The inspector suspended our local plan 2 years ago for greater clarity on the transport strategy that underlay it. So actually there's quite a lot of certainty over that. And I can't believe that we're still coming out with the old argument about congestion charging being a tax and being something of last resort. That's last century's arguments. What intelligent charging, as it's now called, actually is a very effective means of driving modal shift and of creating a sustainable revenue stream which will pay for public transport, be it a metro, buses or whatever. You know, we have to move on from this antiquated way of thinking. And particularly for somewhere like Cambridge, it works in Durham, which is, you know, slightly smaller than Cambridge. We've got to have more flexibility in our thinking. And it's not about having single solutions. It's about having a menu of solutions that work together to drive improvements throughout the whole area. And, you know, just to dismiss congestion charging, intelligent charging, just is a nonsense, I'm afraid, at this stage of the game.
Councillor Kelly.
Yeah, just to put it on record, whether you call it intelligent charging or congestion charging, I remain against it as a matter of last resource. I want everything else tried first, whatever the name or brand is.
I think there's a certain reality that has to be faced. And that reality is here before us from the report that we had from Harry Fielding, the industrial strategy, the interim report. The reality of an economy that's growing at more or less 4% per annum, the reality of an economy where, we've heard from Councillor Smith, there's 2,300 people in the housing register in South Cambridgeshire alone, the reality of an economy that's creating jobs in the tens of thousands, and the fact that whilst there are some short-term measures on the table that need to be discussed, the bottom line is that buses that hold 50 people are never going to solve the traffic problems in the south of Cambridgeshire. We have to look at things in a different way. We have to do things in an exceptional way. We have an exceptional county. We should have exceptional public transport. A fully backed land value cap as a method of raising funds necessary. And I still strongly believe that through land value cap, we can raise the funds necessary to build not just a metro for the south of the county, but certainly potential to build an M11 north through the heart of Fenham and up alongside Huntingdonshire. We've mentioned the Third River crossing at Huntington. Now, these schemes are the schemes that are substantial in cost, but also substantial in reward. Reward to the local economy, but moreover, rewarding in delivering the houses necessary to stop some of the problems that we have now of massive unaffordability, of huge differential between those that can go and afford to buy a home in Cambridge and those that cannot. As I said earlier, we do not have a problem of unemployment in Cambridge. We do not have a problem with the strength of our economy. But the problems that we have are ones that not everybody can take part in the opportunities that are afforded to so many in this area. Ultimately, evidence is very clear. You cannot provide growth without infrastructure. It's obvious to anybody. All of you are involved now or have been involved for some significant time in local government. When you try and bolt houses onto towns and villages, it's highly controversial. And the reason why we do that is because there's no actual transport solution to develop world-class garden villages, to deliver people from the place that they live to the place that they work. And Cambridge is an example of how not to do it. Of course, it's an example of how not to do it because it's just metamorphosized into what it has over a relatively short period. But in actual fact, and I slightly disagree with Lewis here, the problem with Cambridge is not getting into the centre. The problem with Cambridge is getting around the city, because the people work in that necklace of science parks, which are all growing, by the way. That's the difficulty. One accident on the A14 or the M11 completely clogs up the entire area, because there's no other opportunity of moving around. And with Park and Ride, there will still be no other opportunity. Because in order to get on the bus, you've got to drive to a car park, invariably in a bad position, not very close to a decent road network. So all you do by creating the right hubs is just move the problem further away. And of course, the growth is coming at such a rate that we'll never keep on top of it. We have a busway that goes to St. and it's relatively successful. But I believe that it is absolutely full already. We're building 12,000 homes at Northstone, linked into the busway. By the time those houses are complete, by the time the buses get to St Ives, they'll be full anymore. If we are going to have sustainable growth in Cambridgeshire, if we are going to create beautiful places for people to live, that people can afford to live in, we have to have a world-class transport system that needs that. The problem I've had over the last 12 months, and it's okay talking about route alignment, but when you're trying to raise the funds necessary to build world-class infrastructure, and by the way, government are not suddenly going to hand us £4-5 billion, if anybody is aware of that, but that just isn't going to happen. The way to do it is through private finance, you raise the money. Now, it's okay saying, well, we'll put the routes in and you come along later. But that absolutely loses the opportunity to get land value capture along the route. Now, that seems so obvious to me that it doesn't seem easy to explain it, but there are clearly, despite 12 months of trying to explain that, that point hasn't come across. And it is, as far as I can see, we have a window of opportunity now to do something exceptional. Not just in Cambridge, but in Huntingdonshire and Fenton as well. And if we are foolish and overcommit to a short-term solution, we will never deliver what's necessary to solve the problems in our county. So whilst I have an understanding of certain schemes, Trumpet and Park and Ride for one, as being necessary to deliver, I cannot commit to Park and Ride being the long-term solution for transport problems in and around the country. In actual fact, just the opposite. I think Park and Ride is actually not a solution, I think it's part of the problem. So any Park and Ride scheme that I agree to in negotiation over the next 2 months, I make it clear, can only be seen as an interim solution, cannot be seen as a long-term solution, because we have to do better. And we have to do better, not just because, oh, wouldn't it be nice to have a better transport system, wouldn't it be nice to have a bus system that has to link stations rather than just driving the bus right in the centre of the town. We have to do better because unless we create a transport system in Cambridgeshire of significant quality, then the people who live here will suffer. They won't just suffer in the short term, they will suffer in the long term too. And it is my belief, it's the absolute right of every single person to have the opportunity to buy their own home. Unless we build the homes on land where we can value, we will never be able to deliver that opportunity to so many people who are working very hard in our economy. So you would expect me to say that this paper is the right paper at the right time. But it absolutely is the right paper at the right time. If we are to take advantage of the opportunities that are out there, we must have a paper that says what we're going to achieve. And we must work together with the GCP to come up with the right solutions. And I intend to do that. I'd like to propose from the Chair, do I have a second? Councillor Seaton.
Can I record a vote, please? Yes, we can record a vote, sorry. If I call out your names, can you please indicate how you are voting yes, no, or abstaining, Councillor Seaton? No. Councillor Count?
Yes.
Councillor Holdage?
Yes.
Councillor Ball?
Yes.
The Mayor?
Yes.
Councillor Herbert?
No.
Roberts?
Yes.
Councillor Seaton?
Yes.
And that's it, that rounds up. So there are two votes against and six votes in favour, so that vote is carried.
Item 3 for Finance Order. Councillor Cowan, can I ask you to introduce this item?
Thank you, Mayor. Back in the day, when the devolution deal was struck with government, there were various parts and parcels to that overall package, and one that was discussed at the time was the business rate supplement order, where it was proposed that the Mayor would have the right to increase rates by a certain amount of the pound,
subject to delivering an outline plan for the purpose of those rates to the communities at large, and then subsequent referendum vote from the business community being in support of that. What hasn't been recognised or realised is in that interim gap, we've actually been waiting for government to issue standing orders on that to take it through Parliament, and those need to actually be ratified by us in the paperwork. So what I'm asking for today is nothing new, difficult, unusual. There is no current intentions to raise any business rates. It's simply asking us to ratify this paper so that we align ourselves with standing orders going through government to actually agree something that we agreed to as part of the devolution deal over a year ago. And that's all I've got to say. There are no current plans to raise any business rates.
Councillor. Yes, it seems to stir the whole that's nested around the press that this is your avenue to raising money for the metro amongst other things, but this was missed out of the original plan, which gives you power, doesn't it? But if I would explain to them, perhaps you'd like to reiterate that, that is there no, absolutely no plan to use combined authority to leverage any business rates.
I will repeat that there are no plans for combined authority to levy any business rates.
Do I have a proposal, please?
Councillor Bull and a seconder. Councillor Seaton, thank you. All those in favour? Thank you very much. 3.4 is the adult education budget. Councillor Holdridge is going to introduce this budget.
Yes, like the previous, but this is something that was promised to us in the devolution bid, and it's been a long while coming. It is about £13 million, and we won't be to affect a great deal of difference to it at this moment, particularly the transfer to work up a plan line. And we do have some plans on education, which should be coming to July, on apprenticeship and school readiness, and also we've been working with a particular academy to see if we have an alternative curriculum in school, not across obviously the whole school, but for those young people that are not going to get 5 days overseas or don't follow that route, an alternative curriculum in the school. And all those should be coming out in July. And we will then work on this thing. I think there's 9 providers in here, but what we don't have at the moment is a direction of travel for them. But we can't affect it without 12 months because we've got the money and they've got the contract. So if that doesn't come up, we need to say what we want to do.
Councillor
Bell. Councillor Hodditch has introduced this pretty clearly. I think the broader issue which we do need to have more discussion on is exactly what our role is in this 16-19 and further education. I understand that in terms of the Economic Commission, quite a lot of evidence has been raised that particularly 16-19 provision is just not meeting fully the needs of the students or of potential employment, given the huge opportunities people with skill have got within our area. So I'd hope that we can bring forward further discussion, and if that involves challenging government, then so be it. I just don't think at the moment that we've been in a position to fulfil our obligations that we took on, because we actually volunteered to take on a number of these issues. But I understand some of the problems, including that this order was due about a year ago, as an example.
This is how I think it's supposed to come across with the devolution deal, but it's been promised and the shadow of the year and all sorts of things. It's come across there, we've got it, and our new business strategy that the Commission will work out will allow some influence.
Councillor Holdridge, I assume you are going to propose?
Yes, I propose that.
Can I have a seconder, please? Councillor Herbert, all those in favour? Thank you very much. Item 4.1 on the agenda is Treasury Management Strategy, Council Accounts. And I understand you also would like to move the amendment.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. I'll brief narrative, please, and then I'll propose the amendment.
So, first of all, it's right and proper that we have a treasury management strategy. It's laid out very clearly for the board to consider. It has been to Audit and Accounts, who's asked us to review our investment strategy as part of that, which we're happy to do so. And I think, you know, in the first year of the combined authority running, I think my main concern was to make sure the money was safe. But we will be looking at an appropriate risk stroke investment background in the future. In terms of the amendment I wish to propose, it's come to light that there are some minor points that perhaps could do with some tidying up, and rather than deal with them one by one, I have to propose an amendment that will be a capsule that will be able to handle it that way. I'll give you a flavour of those amendments in 1 second. But anything that is delegated for a subsequent amendment, just as I was describing earlier, I'd expect full transparency to be reported to the board, the Audit and Accounts Committee, and posted on the web, etc. So just a very quick indication. 9.4, I want to look at indicator 9, which talks about the maturity structure of the borrowing and how much you can have in certain time periods, but it doesn't have anything about should that all land in the same year, so I just want to have a better look at that. At the very end of the paper, it talks about the role of the combined authority, it talks about the role of the accounts committee, it talks about the role of the Section 105 officer, but quite remiss of me, it doesn't talk about the role of the strategic portfolio holder for finance, and I'm sure I'm involved in this somewhere, so we'll try and get that in. In another area, it talks about 13.11, it talks about the institutions that may fall out of credit worthiness for investments, and should they fall off that list, and remember, if they're on the list, they may have some of our money with them, then it's actually recommended that it's a board decision to remove them from the list, whereas I would suggest that it's an immediate decision for action to be subsequently reported to the board. We do not want to wait for a board cycle if somebody is a judged arm and to be at more risk than we agreed to in the first place. So it's that kind of general thing. I don't think there'll be any objections to the one amendment, but also there's any comments from here, we can catch them up in this one amendment. So the amendment I'm proposing is an additional amendment, and that is that that responsibility for any additional minor amendments required to the Treasury Management Strategy to be delegated to the Chief Finance Officer in consultation with the Portfolio Holder for Fiscal Strategy, all such amendments to be circulated to the Audit and Governance Committee and members of the Combined Authority Board.
Anybody happy with the amendment? Seconder to the amendment. Councillor Seconder. So the amendment is up for debate. Anybody have any comments to make? Anybody happy with the proposal as amended?
No, I'd just like to
get a course.
In supporting the amendment, I just want to say that this is not the dull report, or this isn't the dull area that it kind of suggests, and I just I do think that we should be bringing back, and I know Councillor Cambs referenced it, report about how better to use the significant cash flow, because with the way that the government is funding and is forward funding the evolution, we've got significant cash flow. And we've also got this borrowing opportunity. If we look at councils and all of the organisations that are part of the combined authority, we've all completely reviewed how we use our treasury assets and our resources. And I just think there's significant opportunity, and I know that Council Count is working on it, to effectively create rolling funds and forward funds, provided, as you're saying, that that's done without risk or it's guaranteed by councils or other bodies. Effectively, what we've been doing is loaning out at near-nil interest money, rightly, as you say, so that it's safe, but that opportunity could be made available, and I think the money would be just as secure as sending it to the Highlands of Scotland.
Yeah, absolutely, is our outline. That's a piece of work for us. We will put that in front of the board for approval because it is that balance of investment risk against return. But I'm absolutely aligned with you. It's all a matter of timing today. What we have been able to achieve in a very complex arena, very fast changing very fast, moving arena compared to what we wish to do. So safety first, and then investment returns second. That's very much underway. The borrowing cap, as you talked about, that is clearly indicated in the report for 2018-19 for 2019-20. That is the maximum amount that we agreed with the Majesty's Treasury that we could borrow. At this point in time, I would say that I don't believe that we have the intentions to borrow that. They're simply there, should we need to use it, and any thoughts of any borrowing would obviously be a board decision anyway, before we could make any borrowing. Once we want to get past 2019-20, as the infrastructure plans, housing plans, etc., become more fleshed out, we will, of course, have discussions with HMT to see what that borrowing might look like. But still, even if we have a borrowing limit, the last place we want to be doing is borrowing when we have the resources such as internal borrowing that we would do first. So the entire plan, to sum it all up, is now that we've got the sort of safety under our belt, it is my absolute intention to make the best use of our money without taking inadequate risk.
So we have a proposal. So those in favour? That's unanimous, thank you. So the date of the next meeting is the 27th of June.